happens today, oh boy. 4,000 holes in Blackburn, Lancashire. Takes to fill the album.
This is Jim Fetzer, your host on The Real Deal, with my very special guest today is Donna Janeczko, who together with Patty Woodard has created a special website, noncombatdeath.org, which I invite everyone to visit. This is the first in a series of programs we're going to devote to this subject, which concerns the death of military personnel not due to combat. Cases that are often classified by the military as suicides, but may more often, I'm sorry to say, turn out to be homicides. And these are heart-wrenching cases. Patty Woodard thought I might be interested in this because of a recent column I published on Op-Ed News discussing, under the title, Has Cheney Been Murdering Americans?, in which I discussed the deaths of Minnesota Senator Paul Wellstone, Corporal Pat Tillman, the NFL star who died in Afghanistan, and a 9/11 activist by the name of Beverly Eckert who died in the Buffalo plane crash, all of which cases appear to be very suspicious, where I lay out the evidence about them in that article. So anyone who would like a, you know, kind of a background to this might want to do a Google on Has Cheney Been Murdering Americans? Now, Patty told me in response to having read that column that she and my guest today, Donna Janeczko, had created this website. Both of them have suffered the loss of children in relation to deaths that appear to be very strange and not adequately explained by the military. So, Donna, I'm very grateful to you for coming on the show today and for, you know, giving the audience the opportunity to learn more about what you and Patty have been doing together and, you know, specifics, including about your own son's death that might be of informative value to American citizens who need to know what's happening to our own children when they incur military service.
Well, I'm glad to be here to be able to talk to you. I might correct Patty is an activist in many issues, military, especially PTSD and so forth. She has not had a child and has not lost one, but she and I were working on another project called Mama with Jan Demedic at the time that we met, and we just sort of branched off and started a fresh website for families of non-combat death incidents.
So just to repeat for the benefit of our audience, that website is non-combat-death, singular.org.
That's
How long have you been pursuing these issues, Donna?
Well, my son was killed in 2001, so I had no, you know, interest in this prior to that. Patty and I got together in 2003, and we set up this website, and we also set up a blog, which mainly will carry current articles that have to do with non-combat deaths. And we also formed an email list, which is private, and it's for families of military personnel killed in non-combat death situations. So we have maybe 20 members or so, maybe a few more than that.
Could you tell us a bit about your son and his background and before he entered the military?
Well, that would take maybe a four-hour show because this, my son's case is particularly complicated, and I think people's heads would be spinning if I gave too much detail at this point. I'm working on a book based on my notes from all these past 8 years, and hopefully, you know, we'll put that out at some point. My prior to going in the military, my son was a nerd. He's a very academically oriented kid, very much into the sciences. And
Donna, you may be a little too close to your microphone or to your phone. Back just a hair. Yeah, thanks.
How's that?
Better.
Okay, good. So what do I need to back up to?
Just continue speaking.
Okay.
So he was a nerd. He was into the sciences, mathematics.
Right. He was Latin. He was a national Latin scholar in high school. You know, really exciting things like that. He graduated with honors. Unfortunately, the military recruiters were allowed to go into his high school, and teachers kind of encouraged these military scholarships, and he got two or three. He got them from almost every branch of the military services, and I tried to discourage him. I didn't feel like it was a good match for him. I have nothing against the military services. I'm very supportive of the troops, but it wasn't a good match for Loren, and Loren couldn't even make the physical requirements to get into the military, and yet he was encouraged and sort of suckered into taking a military scholarship.
That's
how he got. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to talk over.
No. It's very odd that he'd be recruited if he weren't, you know, passing the physical. I mean, that's the most basic requirement.
I don't know what it was about him that they wanted, but they wanted him very badly. I remember all the recruiters, because I had two sons, all the recruiters constantly calling our house, and I would tell them, don't call here anymore. You know, these kids are in high school, it's too early for them to be making these decisions. But anyway, Loren took a full Army scholarship.
Tell me about the scholarship. What did the scholarship entail?
Well, it was a full scholarship to, why can't I think of it? What's the famous school? Johns Hopkins in Baltimore. He was interested in something like biomedicine. Of course, he was an 18-year-old kid. He didn't know what he wanted to do in life. And he took this scholarship. And by the time he figured out that maybe he made a mistake and wanted to get out of it, the Army told him, sure, you can get out, but you'll have to pay us back the $40,000 we spent on you this year. So he reasoned it out, and he decided that he hated Johns Hopkins, and he wanted to get out of the scholarship, so he would give the Army what he promised, which was 2 years active duty service. So that's what he did. He went into the infantry, you know, rather than take a lieutenantship or however they do all that, so that they're officers when they get out of college. He went in as a private, and it turns out that eventually he kind of caught on to this soldiering thing, and he became a very good soldier, I think. He was very skilled, you know, but he had an academic bent, and so as soon as he was able to, he got out and he went to school on his own and got a degree. But when he died, he was in debt more than anything else.
Well,
I think that was a really unfortunate. It's unfortunate the way that they convince young kids, 18-year-old kids, to join the military, take a scholarship, you know, make a contract for a financial commitment before they're anywhere near ready to be making those kinds of decisions. But that kind of channeled what was going to happen to him in his life, and ultimately the end of his life.
What part of the country, where do you live? What high school
was
it?
In high school?
Yeah.
We were living in Florida at that time.
Whereabouts?
And we lived in a nice suburb, they'd hate it if I said it was a suburb, little city near Orlando called Winter Park, Florida.
Winter Park, Florida. So this was a Winter Park High School that he graduated from?
That's right.